Hello, this is your host, Todd Lewis of the Praise of Folly podcast. Today I'm joined by a special guest, Peter Hammond, and we're here to talk about the First World War. So thank you very much. Thank you for taking time out of your busy day, Peter, to do this. Why don't we begin with what is the conventional narrative of the First World War, and why do you think that's incorrect or deficient?
Well, I mean, the narrative, which has been distorted by Hollywood and a few thousand bizarre films, inspired by real events, based upon a true story, which means some of this might have happened. The names and the places are probably true, but the facts have been distorted in order to protect the guilty and to demonize the victims. So Hollywood's completely messed it up. You know, we were the good guys, the Germans were the bad guys, and we saved the world for democracy and freedom, and everyone's lived happily ever after, ever since. And thank goodness they did, because otherwise, you know, things might be going badly for us, which, of course, they're not, because we saved the world. And the whole world's been saved by us, and thank God for America, because America saved the world over and over, and for no motives whatsoever except altruistic generosity of spirit and that sort of thing. So that's kind of the official narrative, but of course facts are inconvenient things. They get in the way.
Yeah, one of those inconvenient facts is when it comes to the origins of that war. I don't know if you're familiar with George Kennan's work, the Franco-Russian Alliance, but yes. That's very important work, because it demonstrates that 22 years prior to 1914, France and Russia already agreed to dismember Germany for their own imperial ambitions. This is, again, 22 years prior to the actual outbreak of the conflict.
Yes. You see, what people also need to bear in mind is the whole balance of history. And if you take a world map, which most have not, and look at it, the first thing you notice is Germany is an extremely small country, as was Austria-Hungary, compared to Russia and the whole Russian Empire, and France and a huge French Empire, which is one of the biggest in the world, and then the British Empire, which is colossal. I mean, the British controlled 1/5 of the world's land surface and population. And so if you take a world map, and then this business of Britain all alone and poor little France, well, actually, you can see that Germany was surrounded and it was fighting a two-front war. In fact, very quickly, a three-front war once Italy got brought in on the Allied side. And this was a huge area. And Germany, being a highly industrial country, could not survive without massive imports. In fact, 3/4 of their food had to be imported. They could not survive on what they could grow. So the hunger blockades, the Royal Navy's blockade of not just military supplies, but food, which was something new in the annals of Christian nations warfare, that you would not only blockade weapons, but blockade food. And so the Americans were calling it a hunger blockade, and your Secretary of State was complaining that, in fact, what Britain was doing was a war crime, which by the Geneva Convention it certainly was, that they were starving the people of Germany and Austria by this blockade. And they're very narrow openings to the sea. It didn't take the Royal Navy much to blockade completely, not just take their colonies, but to actually be starving the population to death, so that literally hundreds of thousands of German women and children were dying of starvation even after the war was over. 8 months after the war was over, after the 11th of November 1918, everyone signed the peace treaty at Versailles, and Germany had laid down their weapons, hand over the navy and a whole lot of other things, and all their gold. They still were enforcing the blockade, and people were still dying of starvation by the tens of thousands a month. More people dying than were being born, literally, 8 months after the war was over. So, you know, just to consider, so this picture of, you know, they outnumbered us, well, numerically, militarily, territory, industry-wise, they were always outnumbered. We always, the Allies always outnumbered Germany, both First and Second World War, and it was more like international bullies ganging up. But the thing that is so striking is, bear in mind, what actually started the First World War? Well, most historians would agree that the spark that lit the tinderbox, as some put it, was the assassination of Archduke Franz Ferdinand, the heir to the throne of Austria, and his beautiful wife Sophie, on their 10th wedding anniversary, mind you, in Sarajevo, which is a place that's continued to cause grief to this day for very good reasons. And so on the 28th of June, 1914, the heir to the Austrian Empire and his wife are murdered by a Marxist terrorist, a Serbian nationalist, real radical anarchist, really a Marxist, 18 years old at that, interestingly. He even survived the war because by Austrian law, you couldn't execute a person who was under 21. So the incredible thing is, at the time that this happened, all over the world, there was horror, revulsion. What a disgusting act. The Russians, the British, the Americans, everyone around the world sympathized with Austria and railed against this rogue nation, this terror-sponsoring state of Serbia. And Serbia had sponsored many terrorist attacks, including the bombing of Queen Victoria's granddaughter, who was getting married to the King of Spain, and they got bombed on their wedding day in the wedding procession, including stabbing to death with an ice pick the Empress of the Austrian Empire. That's Franz Ferdinand, the Emperor's wife, stabbed to death with an ice pick. And there was a whole range of assassinations of key people, governors and generals and so on, and women and children. So you can see, for example, Serbia itself, its king and queen were murdered by the very terrorists who were running Serbia at the time of 1914. So Serbia was a rogue state, it was a terror-sponsoring state, and just about the whole world agreed with us. So how did we end up, a month later, I'm talking about Britain, my ancestors fought, in fact, we lost 480 Hammonds died for the British Empire in the First World War alone, most of them in Belgium, actually. And just within 10 kilometers of Ypres, you can see the graves of 64 Hammonds. So, you know, we really, our family was heavily involved in that. But how did we end up on the side of the terrorists? Because the terrorists weren't just targeting the Austrian royal family, but all the royal families. I mean, even relatives of Queen Victoria. Do you know that when America entered the war on the side of the revolutionaries, the terrorists, the communists, and all the rest of it? Because, I mean, do you know that Woodrow Wilson had the Serbian flag flown from the White House every 28th of June, to which is the anniversary of what? The anniversary of an assassination of a very moderate man, Franz Ferdinand, and his beautiful wife, Sophie. And it was a terrorist act. They fired shots and threw bombs at this open vehicle that had virtually no security, visiting this city that had been liberated from the Turks just within that living memory of that generation. So the Austrians had literally liberated most of the Balkans, including Sarajevo, from the Ottoman Turks, who'd been oppressing them for centuries. And here's the most moderate royal in the whole of Europe, probably. And the radicals target him. And we end up fighting to bring down the Austrian Empire that had protected Europe for centuries from the Ottoman Turks, so the Ostermark, the Austrian Empire. We bring down the German Empire, which had protected Europe from the Huns and the Mongols and all the Eastern hordes for centuries. And of course, the Russian Empire came down, and the Bolsheviks took power there. They were the only real winners of the First World War. And that's the side we were on. And of course, the French were very secular humanist. Remember, Europe had been pillaged and tyrannized by France and revolutionary forces since the French Revolution. And Germany had been, in fact, the stomping ground of a lot of the looting and destruction of the French revolutionary forces. And that's actually going back even to the 30 Years' War in the 1600s. So Germany was not the military aggressor of Europe, France was. They had done more invasions than anybody else. Russia would have been the second most notorious villain of Europe in some ways of thinking, such as with when Britain and France took the side of Ottoman Muslim Turkey against Russia in the Crimean War of the 1850s, although plainly Russia was on the right side then, we were on the wrong side. But the Ottoman Turks were, of course, a real serious threat. So why were we getting rid of the two greatest empires and nations in the center of Europe, who had been historically the ones who protected Europe from Eastern revolutionary Islamic jihadist forces? So the entire narrative we've been given about the First World doesn't make sense when you understand the fact that we were on the side of the assassins, the terrorists. You know, it's just like America's gone to how many wars just recently to fight rogue terrorist sponsoring nations? Although they've often missed those, because I believe the biggest terrorist sponsoring nation in the world today would be Saudi Arabia, whose most favored nation status. But forget the fact that it's mostly their money, armaments, and their citizens doing most of the terrorism. They are not considered a rogue terrorist nation, but countries that haven't sponsored terrorists are labeled as that. But imagine if we chose to be starting a world war on behalf of the rogue terrorist nations. Would that not be bizarre?
It would be. It would be. I've made such an analogy myself. Serbia was a terrorist state. The head of the secret intelligence ran the Black Hand, the terrorist organization that committed all these atrocities. And furthermore, there's strong evidence that the Black Hand was operating in conjunction with elements of the Russian government.
Yes.
After the war, Luigi Albertini, the great Italian historian, wrote that Artemanov, one of Russia's ambassadors, representatives to Serbia, met with the head of secret military intelligence days before the assassination. And one of the guards, listening to the conversation behind the door, he heard the APIS, that was the code name for the head of the intelligence, saying that if we shoot the Archduke, we're going to war. And the Russians said, fine, we'll back you up. That's what he testified after the war that he heard. And this kind of, it's been known at least since the 40s, and yet none of it has trickled down to the popular media.
Well, we know the reason for that, because the people running Hollywood mostly seem to love the communists. They see no enemies to the left. And how many films have been made on the Gulag archipelago, on the massacres under Stalin and Lenin and Khrushchev, and all the way through the Gorbachev years? How many exposés have there been made of the Holodomor, of the wiping out of over 6 million Ukrainians just in the 1930s through the planned starvation, where they literally starved the people to death, destroying all their food supplies? And in fact, Stalin made some very callous remarks. He said, the death of one person is a tragedy, but the death of a million is just a statistic. And he said, it does not matter who, it does not count who votes, but what matters is who counts the votes. And there's so many cynical comments. And yet you think how we went into the Second World War to help Joseph Stalin. And the First World War, the biggest winners were the Soviet Union. The Second World War, the biggest winners were the Soviet Union and Red China, because the forces that were preventing the expansion of communism in China would have been Japan. They were waging a war in China to keep the communists down. You think how we've been complaining about the danger of communist China since 1945? Well, we wouldn't have had to worry about it if we just left the Japanese alone. They were dealing with the communists in China effectively. But when you destroy the greatest anti-communist force in Asia, and you destroy the greatest anti-communist force in Europe, Germany, then, well, what do you think? In fact, it's worse than that. We didn't just destroy what was threatening to destroy communism in both Russia and China. We saved the Soviet Union with lend-lease, with billions and trillions of dollars worth of aid on the highest levels to keep Stalin in power. And even Russian historians today are saying, well, without Lend-Lease, Russia wouldn't have survived the end of 1941. I mean, the Soviet Union wouldn't have survived. I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
So,
I've suddenly lost...
Yeah, sorry about that.
You mentioned audio.
In one of your articles, you mentioned the Lusitania and how that drew America into the conflict, and how there's been inaccurate reporting on that incident.
That is true, because the Lusitania, wow, that was probably the most volatile public event, which is cited by almost all historians as a key step on the way to getting the United States, which was very anti-interventionist, anti-war, into the First World War. In fact, it was said that in 1916, something in the region of 85% of Americans would have been anti-intervention, isolationist, don't get involved in Europe's wars, which of course was the advice of your first president. George Washington said, avoid entangling alliances and do not get involved in Europe's wars. And that was a major part of American foreign policy for a very long time. And Woodrow Wilson even had the audacity to campaign in the 1916 presidential election, he kept us out of Europe's wars. Then he immediately got you into it afterwards. In fact, he had been planning it all along, and he was, in fact, a very duplicitous and deceitful individual. It turns out that while he was talking peace, he was conspiring for war to such an extent that a Secretary of State broke and resigned the administration over that very point, that how can you break your promises, and how can we get involved in this war? And we're getting involved on the wrong side anyway. If we were to get involved at all, why are we on the side of the aggressors? And so there's a very strong argument against getting involved over that. But the Lusitania, the first thing that strikes one as something really strange here is the Lusitania's files were sealed for 60 years, that's 6-0. 60 years. Now, you know that when a government seals files, it's because they've lied. And so the British government sealed these files. No historian could look at it, the Lusitania files, until 60 years later. And when that came out, I remember, in fact, this one of the first books that really shook my world was in 1975 when I read The Sinking of the Lusitania. It was about how this was something the British and American governments planned together to get a major ship sunk in order to have a public relations propaganda tool to give the American government an excuse to mobilize the population of America into the war that virtually nobody in the country wanted. And they were able to plan this. Now, the first Lord of the Admiralty of Britain in 1915 was Winston Churchill. And Winston Churchill, who was the only member of the British cabinet in 1914 who supported going to war. The British Prime Minister Asquith didn't want anything to do it. All of them were loath, but the Foreign Secretary was keen, and the First Lord Admiralty on the cabinet was pushing for it, and he rammed this through against everyone else's wishes. And it's quite extraordinary. Winston Churchill is the only person who was involved in both the leading of his country in the First World War and the Second. Pivotal, in fact. He was about the only war advocate in the British cabinet in the First and the Second World War, and he managed to push both together so much so that in Patrick Buchanan's excellent book, Churchill, Hitler, and the Unnecessary War, How Britain Lost to Empire and the West Lost the World, very long title, but very descriptive. Patrick Buchanan shows how this Churchillian cult that has led America into so many wars recently, this idea that Churchill saved the world and Churchill was the greatest Englishman in the 20th century, is actually fiction, and it's a myth, and he's an idol, and he doesn't deserve the respect and the adulation he's given. And far from saving Britain, he actually took Britain from the premier world superpower, the greatest power the world has ever seen, economically, militarily, politically, spiritually, missionary-wise, in every way. Britain led the world, and America was, in fact, a very small power compared to the British Empire at the beginning of the First World War. But Churchill, in leading his country into this extremely unwise war, for no benefits for Britain, mind you, but it started the bankruptcy and the collapsing of the British Empire, and the Second World War finished it off totally. So Britain then became a fourth-rate empire. And who were the only real winners of the First and Second World War? Soviet Union and, to a less extent, the United States. But the Soviet Union was the big winner of them. And this is something that has become clearer with time. And all the propaganda of how we saved the world and we saved democracy and we fought for Western Christian civilization and yay, aren't you glad the good guys won? And we look around thinking, could things be worse? if the other side had won? I mean, in what way is the world better today? In fact, the world today is immeasurably worse than it was in 1914, and immeasurably worse than it was in 1939. And how on earth can we say we saved the world for democracy when we were allied to the terror sponsoring Serbia in the First World War, helped the Soviet Union, and then saved the Soviet Union in the Second World War, and then betrayed Chiang Kai-shek's nationalist government of China, and really compelled the coming to power of Mao Zedong. At the end of the Second World War, your marshal, the chief of staff of the United States Army, he said that he had, with one stroke of the pen, disarmed 36 of Chiang Kai-shek's divisions, because he ordered all the ships that were taking weapons across the Atlantic to China just dump the weapons overboard to disarm Chiang Kai-shek's divisions, because, oh, we don't need them anymore because the war's over. And I mean, what a waste. You think of all those people who are scraping, saving to build this arsenal for democracy, most of which weapons went to the Soviet Union, which was not a democracy, let alone free or Christian. In fact, it was the most anti-Christian, persecuted church in history. And to think that most of the weapons and the metal and the drives for scrap iron and all this, that it actually ended up either in the Soviet Union or at the bottom of the ocean. What would the people who made all the sacrifices think of that, let alone the ones who gave their lives?
I know. They probably wouldn't like it that much. But this idea of ratting allies out by not giving them weapons, the same thing happened during the Civil War in Russia. Kolchak of Siberia ordered weapons, and the head of the American AEF refused to give him the weapons. He ordered them from the U.S. government, and there was a major Soviet offensive led by their brilliant General Tukhachevsky, and they didn't get the resources that they had paid for. And as you pointed out, in China, the same thing happened. They paid for these resources to fight the communists, and they weren't given to them. And, well, it's kind of hard to fight the communists when you don't have any ammunition, food, or gas. One of the points you made, I think it's a good one, is that the two world wars really gave rise to international communism. The First World War laid the foundation for the Soviet state, and the Second World War eliminated the Soviet state's two chief rivals, Nazi Germany and Imperial Japan. One of the interesting things about with Japan is that this has come out after the Venoda records have been revealed, that Soviet agents in the United States, like Harry Dexter White, were actively feeding disinformation to the U.S. government to incite a conflict with Japan, because they were aware that if Japan were busy fighting us, they wouldn't be... Japan, what they wanted to do was to create an anti-communist front in Asia to destroy the Soviet Union. And the Soviets also knew that Germany wanted to do the same thing in Europe. So they knew they couldn't fight both at once, so they indirect Japan against the United States by using their spy networks. In Japan with Richard Sorge, in the United States with Harry Dexter White, and then Owen Littmore in China and Chungking. This is all recorded in... Blacklisted by History by M. Stanton Evans, which is a defense of McCarthy, who's often been unfairly maligned for calling out all these communists that were infiltrating our government. Also, Diana West's America Betrayed is a very good book on the topic as well.
Interesting. I've just finished a major history on the Secret War. It's written by Sir Max Hastings. The Secret War, it's a history of the whole intelligence war throughout the Second World War, so from 1939 to 1945, on the British, French, German, American, Polish, Russian, on all sides, Japanese sides. So it's a phenomenal overview of what was going on throughout the wars. And according to Sir Max Hastings, who was given access to all the files of virtually every single one of these countries, which is an extraordinary record, and it's staggering how often you get the facts coming over that the British Secret Service was riddled with communists. The American SOE, Special Operation, OSS, the British had the SOE, the Americans had the OSS under a Wild Bill Donovan, who was about as Marxist as they come. His number two man right next to him, Duncan Lee, was a member of the KGB. He was working for the NKGD, NKVD, which later became the KGB, and later proved to be a communist spy. And as Max Hastings, who's British, continually points out, it's extraordinary how everything that the Allies did on the intelligence war helped the communists. They betrayed the royalists in Yugoslavia. Who would have thought they would have been supporting Druze Mihailovic? Because, I mean, he's a royal, he's conservative. But they were supporting Marshal Tito's communist partisans continually. Everywhere that the OSS of America under Wild Bill Donovan or the SOE of Britain went, they worked with the communists. They helped the communists in Italy. They helped the communists in Greece. There wouldn't have even been a Greek civil war afterwards if it hadn't been for the British SOE operations in Greece, arming the Allied terrorists who later fought for the communists. And the fact that they didn't succeed in Greece was no thanks to Britain, because they sure tried. But Yugoslavia was betrayed into the hands of the communists under Tito, which was a brutal regime for 45 years, by the Allies. And they went through the betrayal of the people all over Eastern Europe. And there was the interesting comments regularly that you get from Sir Max Hastings. How, when the operatives went into Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia, or anywhere in Eastern Europe, actually, they found the people unwilling to cooperate with them, because they said, the Germans are our only hopes against the communists. Why would we want to help you who allied with Stalin? And they were sort of bewildered by this. Huh, that's strange. Why is it that they're more afraid of Stalin's government? Well, maybe they're living a little closer. And of course, they experienced the betrayal, and they experienced the communist invasion in 1940, and then the German liberation in 1941. And that's the way they saw it. And so, you skip. And then you find out these interesting things, like in the patent papers, how there were one of the other top generals from Ukraine and other parts in the Russian sphere who came over to the West and told them the man at the top of the NKVD assassination list is General George Patton. Patton is going to be assassinated. Beware, warn General Patton. Stalin has given us the highest. And every one of these people who came over and informed the OSS on this, what happened to them? They were handed back to Stalin's NKVD. So Max Hastings' secret war, without openly coming to the conclusion that the Allies were completely and utterly controlled by the communists, he puts it down to, well, they were obviously infiltrated by them. They were riddled with communist infiltrators. Yes, there was Kim Philby, and there was McLean, and there was Blunt and Fuchs, and yes, there was just Ken Cross. There was just masses of communists amongst them, and it's true that the Americans made all kinds of mistakes. And a strange thing how Wild Bill Donovan continually appointed key communists to key positions, and he always seemed to favor them, but he puts it down to, like, they didn't understand or they were mistaken. But with the benefit of hindsight, it now looks like, look, if you make a mistake, you're human, we all make a mistake. If you make the same mistake twice or three times, you're stupid. You make the same mistake dozens of times, you have a hidden agenda. Now, there's no way you can believe that the US Secret Service or the British Secret Service were so stupid that they continually helped the communists, and they did. In fact, the conclusions, interestingly put there by Sir Max Hastings, who's the official biographer, that the generals of the General Chief of Staff of the British High Command came to the conclusion at the end of the war that nothing that SOE or MI6 did in the war, which was colossally expensive, 16,000 assassinations and sabotage terrorist operations done by the British SOE alone on the continent, officially. That's not even counting the American OSS. And the billions they sucked up. And I said that the conclusion at the end of the war by the Chief of Staff of Britain is that they had no significant impact on the result of the war, as far as Britain goes. That it did nothing militarily to end the war earlier or to ensure victory in any of the theatres whatsoever, and that in fact all they'd done is actually helped communist partisans take over countries and put them behind the Iron Curtain. And the damning effect on the OSS is actually even worse than on the British SAE, because what Wild Bill Donovan's OSS people did to China, betraying the whole of China into the hands of communism, which is, as you know, to this day, one of the biggest communist hellholes in the world, and the one of the least free countries on the planet. And you know, there's people talking today about North Korea. Oh, what a threat. Well, who gave North Korea to the communists? Well, Truman, actually. President Truman. It was America called Russia in when the war was over, gave them Sakhalin Island of Japan and North Korea. And even when the American army under General MacArthur had fought very hard, from almost having lost the whole of South Korea, not only liberate the whole of South Korea, but liberate the whole of North Korea, right up to the Yellow River, and then in order to withdraw back to the 38th parallel, because you've got to give North Korea back to the communists again. So North Korea has been betrayed by the US government a couple of times. And the fact that it now seems to, apparently, from the people who continually lie and give false flag operations, it seems to be a threat to the United States today. Well, if it is, whose fault is that? And when did that start? Is it not the result of Potsdam, 1945, when Truman asked Russia to please take it and handed it to them?
Well, exactly. I mean, during World War II, we trained the Viet Cong. I mean, we trained the Viet Cong forces to fight the Japanese. We trained the communists to fight the Japanese. And yet, at the end of the day, we had to fight the communist Chinese and the Viet Cong. What did we gain out of that? You know, I like to ask people, what was so bad about letting Japan have China? Is it any worse than having the communists have China? There's really no appreciable there's a good deal of difference, because the Japanese wouldn't have been as psychotic as the communists. If you read Mao, The Untold Story, I've heard from estimates from that book that 70 plus million people were killed by the communists. Now, the other thing that can't be forgotten as well is that in the Soviet Union and in China, specifically China with its wicked one-child policy, we don't want to look at just the body counts of people that died in gulags, as horrible as that was, but the children that were murdered. In China, with the one-child policy, over 300 million children were murdered by order of the state. And in Russia, when they legalized abortion under Lenin, it was so bad, Stalin had to ban it again because the population was collapsing. And then after Stalin died, Khrushchev legalized it again. And Russia has aborted almost 300 million children under the Soviet Union. So that's 600 million children, not counting the people that, of course, died in the gulags and the torture chambers. Unimaginable death toll. The Japanese wouldn't even come close to that.
No, I mean, this is the thing. Now, interesting enough, I was brought up in Rhodesia, last British colony. So 1970s, we were fighting a war against Soviet communism. In fact, I was brought up with rifles everywhere. The teachers carried machine guns. Mothers had a pistol on their hip or a 9mm submachine gun over their shoulder while they were pushing their baby carriage in the shops and doing their shopping. It was just, that was life. That was normal. You closed the curtains before you switched on the light. You switched off the light before you went out the door. We went on roads endangered by landmines. We went in convoys. Farmers were targets. This was life for us. We were a little country with a small population, miniature army. Total number of helicopters for the whole Rhodesian Defense Force was 40. That was our entire air infantry. The biggest aerial assault we ever did, external, where we destroyed the terrorist camp, headquarters at Chimoio, was a camp of 5,000 terrorists. The total airborne assault capacity of Rhodesia with no reserves was 198 airborne soldiers were dropped on Chimoio, and they beat and wiped out the base, I might say. But there wasn't one helicopter in reserve. Every single airborne soldier in the whole Rhodesian army was there, and it wasn't even 200. So you see, we were a small country. We were declared by the United States and the Soviet Union and Red China as a threat to world peace. So Rhodesia, fighting for its life against Soviet-backed terrorists who were hacking our missionaries to death, who were bayoneting pastors to death, who were herding congregations into churches and burning it down around them. And those terrorists who were murdering our people were funded by the World Council of Churches, the United Nations, and everyone from the US State Department, the British Foreign Office were helping the terrorists who were attacking us. So much so that it came out. Now, I was a good friend of the last Prime Minister of Rhodesia, Ian Smith, and in the last 20 years of his life, I met him regularly. We had meals together, prayed together, read the Bible together. I interviewed him on radio. And so Ian Smith informed me of a whole lot of things. And one of his comments, now bear in mind, Ian Smith fought all 6 years of the Second World War in the Royal Air Force. He flew Hurricanes and he flew Spitfires. He was shot down twice. Half his face was plastic surgery. I mean, he really, his back was buckled in one of the crashes. His face was burned up in another one. I mean, this man suffered for Britain. And yet, when we were fighting against the communists, the British were aiding the terrorists. The first terrorists are coming over with Mills grenades, Thompson machine guns, Lee Enfield rifles, Webley revolvers. Later, they got AK-47s and RPGs. But the terrorists were supported by the British. He later found out why we lost the war. He said, we were never beaten by enemies. We were betrayed by our friends. And what happened was the head of the Rhodesian Central Intelligence Organization, CIO, Ken Flower, he turned out to be working for MI6. That's the British Secret Intelligence Service, SIS. So Ken Flower, who's the head of Rhodesian intelligence, was working for the British. Now, you would have thought, well, how bad can that be? I mean, like, British. Every single attempt of ours to assassinate the terrorist leader, Robert Mugabe, who, by the way, is in his 37th year of butchering and suppressing his people, thanks to Jimmy Carter's foreign policy, and Andrew Young, thank you. But every time, Ken Flower informed MI6, MI6 informed the communist terrorists, and our attempts to defend our country were frustrated at every point. Now, interestingly enough, while I was in Rhodesia, my history teacher in high school was Mr. Rhys Davies, who happened to be a member of parliament in Rhodesia. Now, back then, you didn't get paid for being a member of parliament. It was an honorary position, and you were meant to have a real job. And you were only away at parliament for a couple of weeks a year because, you know, people are meant to get on with their lives. So interesting, not these professional politicians, career politicians, pensions and all this sort of thing. I mean, they've got no real pay. They even really had to cover their own airfares to get up to the capital in Harare and represent the country. So this member of parliament, who's also my history teacher, said, beware the victor's version. Wartime propaganda becomes peacetime textbooks. And he said, listen, governments lie. He said, I can tell you, I'm in government, and I tell you, governments lie. And as he said, his father had been involved in the British government during the Second World War, and he knew the lies they told. He said, we know that the British government are lying about us, their cousins here in Rhodesia now, during our war. What makes you believe they're telling the truth about the First or Second World War? And I didn't fully understand all the implications of what he's saying. It was quite shocking. But regularly he would sneeringly point out inconsistencies in the textbooks, and he'd really say, don't regurgitate the textbook. Think outside the box. Ask why. Look at the context. Ask what's behind it. Don't take things at face value. Don't get your history from the school textbooks. They're written by professionalized committees appointed by governments. You can't trust the British government on anything. And so I would get this sort of thing from him. And I remember the times we were rebuked for just repeating what you saw in textbook. You're not going to get the truth in the textbook. You've got to do investigative research. You've got to ask the questions. Well, that did help me, because throughout my life, I kept coming across things that didn't make sense. So, for example, there I was, 1960s, at school in Rhodesia, and what's the most popular sensation in the film world at the time? The Man from U.N.C.L.E. I don't know if anyone can remember that, but 1960s, you've got a Russian secret agent and an American secret agent, and they're working for the United Nations to keep the world safe for democracy. Well, I thought The Man from U.N.C.L.E. was just great. But in the school desks next to me in Rhodesia, Bulawayo, there were kids who came from the Belgian Congo. And you may recall Operation Grand Slam. The United States provided the C-130s to transport UN troops to crush an attempt at secession. The Christian southern state of Katanga, the mineral-rich and stable Katanga, seceded from chaos when the Congo was taken over by communists and was under Patrice Lumumba, this Marxist, insane lunatic, who is sacrificing human beings to a statue by the thousands. I mean, people are being wiped out by the communists, Simba, terrorists. And so Katanga, the stable pro-Western Christian state, declared independence. And they were stable. Everything was going fine. The UN invaded them. And we're talking about Pakistani, Indian, Moroccan, Swedish troops with American pilots transporting them in C-160s. They bombed, they strafed, they looted, they killed, they suppressed, they totally destroyed this independent state, which you would have thought is a violation of the UN Charter, and forced them to rejoin the communist chaos of the Congo, which is still in chaos to this day, by the way. Now, I had kids sitting in the chair, desk next to me saying, the UN aren't the good guys. The man from Uncle's lying. The UN are the people who looted our home, who stole everything. When we came in our car, a little VW Beetle with everything we had in there, they got us out the car and they stole everything we had. And we had to walk across the frontier into northern Rhodesia with just the clothes on our back. And you're thinking, the UN did that? I thought the UN were the good guys. Now that's the 1960s. So I'm starting to get a disconnect between the screen tells me this, but real flesh and blood people next to me say something else. My dad spent all 6 years fighting in the Second World War. He was in the 8th Army, bombardier, 25 pounders, under Field Marshal Montgomery, mostly in North African desert in Italy. And my dad had an interest, I mean, he was real king and country. He was a British colonial, strong, and had tremendous loyalty to the queen and the crown. But my dad would make comments like, I can't believe we wasted our time fighting for the French twice. And he would see some American movies on Second World War and he'd sort of scoff and snort sometimes and he'd say, it wasn't like that. And then he'd say things like, that's rubbish. That never happened. There were no atrocities in North Africa. The Germans were honorable enemy, honorable, decent people. Africa Corps were gentlemen. Field Marshal Erwin Rommel was a gentleman. And he would tell us how, you know, at Christmas, we would just sing Christmas carols to one another, walk across and share ration packs. He said, in fact, it wasn't just in Christmas. We played soccer sometimes in the no man's land with the Africa Corps when there was lulls in fighting. He said, after fight, our medics would be treating their boys. Their medics would be treating ours. We'd be walking between one another. He said, they were gentlemen. They wouldn't violate. We didn't even need it written. It was just a gentleman's agreement. And so my father would say, I don't believe any of this. When he is seeing things like the world at war's on, he's saying, this is a bunch of lies. And he'd make comments like, this is getting worse every year. He said, I saw every propaganda reel during the Second World War. All 6 years, I'd never miss the film, whenever you got the chance for the film, and it would always have the propaganda newsreels, you know, rah-rah, and to tell you the worst things they could say about the enemy and the best things they could say about us, even if it was lies and we knew it, because we'd been there, and next thing we told, this is a victory, and we think, really? So my dad would make comments now and then, and he'd say, we never saw any of this war crime stuff on the newsreels during the war. He said, this has just been something that's been cooked up since the Nuremberg trials. It's to cover our crimes and to cover the crimes of our allies of the Soviet Union. And I've met other moths. Now, I don't know if you've got them in America, but in South Africa, we've got the Memorable Order of the Tin Hat. So people who wore the metal helmets. So the members of the Tin Hat are military veterans who fought in the wars. And I've met with Australians, Canadians, British, South Africans, Rhodesians, I mean, a whole range of them, Army, Air Force, Navy, the whole lot. Some people who'd spent 3 years in prison camps in Germany, captured at Tobruk and so on. And that guy said, you know, we were never mistreated. There were times we were hungry, he said, but then our guards were just as hungry. He said, they were also starving. They were under the same conditions we were, but they never mistreated us. And I've had every military veteran I've known of the Second World War. There's less today. I mean, most have died by now, but I'm now 57. I've met a lot of them over the years, some very, very close friends. And they've all said to me, never saw an atrocity committed by the Germans, never heard of an atrocity committed by the Germans by anybody I knew who had seen it themselves, didn't even know of it third hand. I don't believe the propaganda we're getting. I think it's just to cover up, to justify, why did we make all this expense? Why did we have all this sacrifice? Why were we serving the Soviets? And why were we bombing their cities? And when we got there, we had to justify. And so some of them thought, well, they had to exaggerate the story in order to justify why we had been incinerating cities like Dresden and Cologne and Hamburg.
Well, what you've been saying is really interesting, and especially coming from British veterans from the North Africa campaign. These are not, you know, cranks or crazy people that, you know, could easily be written off. These are people that, according to the narrative, would be, you know, heroes, according to the narrative that we get. And so when they come to these conclusions, it really causes you to think.
Yes, it does. Ian Smith, Prime Minister of Rhodesia, who fought all 6 years as one of the few Hurricane and Spitfire pilots shot down twice. And at one point, he was shot down over northern Italy. And he evaded capture and spent 5 months behind enemy lines working with the partisans and derailing railways and all sorts of things. So Ian Smith, a tough as nails, he says to me, just after 6 years fighting in the Second World War, 15 years fighting the communists as Prime Minister of Rhodesia, towards the end of his life, we're sitting down having cups of tea or of meals or interviewing him over the radio, and Ian Smith said to me, you know, Peter, with hindsight, we should have sat out of both wars. Neither the First World War nor the Second World War were our business. It wasn't our fight. And in fact, it wasn't in our interests. And not only was not Rhodesia threatened, Britain wasn't either. If Britain stayed out of it, it wouldn't have even been a world war. Britain made it a world war by getting involved. And he brought up interesting points like, you know, never before in the history of Britain has Britain given a war guarantee to anyone. The war guarantee to Poland, given by Neville Chamberlain in 1939, was absolutely unprecedented. Never been done before since. And Britain had never been an ally of Poland, not before 1939. How strange that this would happen. In fact, this is what really got your president, I think your 31st president, looking into this, as Herbert Hoover was in his book, Freedom Betrayed, and mm-hmm. he looks at why did America and Britain get involved in this war, and why did Poland resist Germany on giving back the Danzig Corridor, which everyone agreed was 98% German. I mean, really and truly, Poland had no right to it, and this was a very bad mistake of the Versailles Treaty. And Germany wanted an alliance with Poland against Russia, and Poland was very anti-communist. In fact, Poland was a military dictatorship, and the head of Poland looked very much like Adolf Hitler and wore a uniform very similar to his, which is probably one reason why you never see a picture of the head of state of the country, because Poland wasn't a democracy, it was a military dictatorship, and it was a very anti-communist, almost fascist state, actually. So it was nationalist. They were certainly very close ideologically to Germany, and Germany wanted Poland as an ally. But the only thing that stood in their way is, well, you've got a whole lot of German citizens under your rule, and they weren't actually being well treated either. And the Danzig Corridor had to be handed back to Germany. I mean, that's even Lloyd George, who had done it as British head of state at the time, agreed. There was a lot of people who agreed this was the right thing to do. Chamberlain agreed it was the right thing to do. But then suddenly America gives its war guarantee to Poland, and Poland resists giving it back, and thinking, why, Germany is offering them so much in return. This would have been a deal, a win-win in every way for everybody. And then suddenly Britain and France give a war guarantee to Poland, and it didn't make sense. And Herbert Hoover, your 31st president, looked at this and said, this doesn't make sense. So after the war, he investigated, and he found out from, and this is in his book, Freedom Betrayed, the Polish were put up to resisting the German demands for their territory back and the people back by the Americans. The British were put up by the American State Department to offer the war guarantee, as was France. They were bribed, they were given huge amounts of financial and political promises. And this was bizarre because Britain never did a thing for Poland. They didn't send them a bomb or a bullet or a bandage. They didn't help them. So the British war guarantee was a meaningless gesture, in fact, a callous gesture, because it gave Poland hope that was actually false. There was no intention on Britain or France's side to lift a finger to help the Poles. And in fact, the British and French did nothing for Poland during the whole time of the Polish campaign. So Poland was actually sacrificed. Now also, as Herbert Hoover points out well, when Poland was invaded by Germany from the west, it was invaded by the Soviet Union from the east. Mm-hmm. Now, at the end of the war, instead of Poland being freed, which the British people had been told was the whole reason why they were in the war in the first place, it gets handed over to the Soviet Union. And a third of its territory gets chunked off and given to the Soviet Union. And this colossal people movement, forced removals of millions, gets moved over to the west. And of course, that's just part of it. It's, in fact, I think Patrick Buchanan put it well in his Churchill, Hitler, and Unnecessary War book. He said, at the end of the Second World War, 100 million Christians in 15 nations were betrayed into the hands of Stalin's Soviet Union, the most brutal, mass-murdering, sadistic, totalitarian government the world has ever seen to that date. Maybe Mao Zedong eclipsed it since in body count, but up till then, Stalin was the worst. And also interesting is Pat Buchanan points out that in 1939, in September, when Hitler's forces invaded Poland, at that point, the 1st of September, 1939, Hitler's body count was under 200. And we haven't counted mostly socialists and communists and Nazis, even homosexual ones like Röhm, who is in charge of this SA branch that Hitler personally killed in his bed with his lover, shot him. So Hitler's body count was less than 200 at the end of August 1939, whereas Stalin's was already over 36 million, already murdered by him. So why was it that we made an alliance against nationalist Germany, but made an alliance with Stalinist Soviet Union, and then went out of our way to betray fine countries, including democracies, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, all the way down through Romania? Why would we betray 100 million Christians in 15 countries? Now, I've worked as a missionary throughout Eastern Europe. I've been all the way from Poland in the north down to Albania in the south, behind the Iron Curtain, before the Iron Curtain came down in the 1980s. So I started to be challenged by my way of thinking also back in the 1980s. I started being asked by our friends in Eastern Europe, what freedom? Democracy? We didn't get any freedom or democracy. What are you talking about? The Second World War was for freedom and democracy. You betrayed us. Now, meaning, I guess I was part of the British world empire, you know, my dad was part of it too. And I was actually quite shocked because I thought, you know, we were on the side of the angels. This is the most righteous crusade in the history of the world. We'd saved the world for freedom, for democracy, for Christian civilization, all this. But then I said, you have got to be kidding. Do you know what we've been suffering over here? And so one of the first wake-up calls for me was going into a church in Poland, in Warsaw, and seeing flowers and candles and a memorial for Katyn, 1940. I said, don't you mean 1941? And they all looked at me with a sneering look, saying, do you believe the communist propaganda? And I was quite shaken because in my history book, Katyn Forest Massacre was done by the Germans in 1941. And they just shook their heads and they said, the Russians did Katyn. Now, at this time, they were still under the communists, they were still under Soviet occupation, and these Christians were being very brave because, I mean, you could go to the gulag for these kind of comments. In fact, many did. And they start to give the facts. Well, I was quite shocked, but it didn't seem to be possible. I mean, could our side be lying to this extent? Well, then they start telling me about the assassination of General Sikorsky. Now, General Sikorsky was the Polish head of state in exile, who in 1943 died in the most suspicious circumstances in Gibraltar. And the Poles to this day are convinced that the British had him assassinated on the request of Joseph Stalin or maybe even Franklin Delano Roosevelt. Because Britain, France, Poland, Russia, United States were part of this great allied force. And the Poles were now saying, we need the International Red Cross to investigate this these uncovered mass graves of what turned out to be over 26,000 of the leaders of the country. I mean, their officers, not just non-commissioned officers and officers in the military, but also the police and the Navy and the Air Force and the chaplains and professors and lecturers at university and journalists. And it was just, they wiped out the entire leadership structure, the cream of Poland, all the intelligence. It was absolutely horrific, cold-blooded massacre. And, you know, one of the worst crimes in history and cold-bloodedly done. And now we know, because even Russia's admitted, Putin handed over the documents, as did Yeltsin earlier, a whole lot, proving with the smoking gun, the letter, the signature of Joseph Stalin, the whole lot. But now we have got generations who were taught the Germans did it. In fact, they got convicted of it. They hung a whole lot of people and shot a whole lot of people for the crime of Katyn at Nuremberg. It turns out the Polish officers were wiped out by the very Russians who were sitting on the panel of justice of the judges. But now the assassination of General Sikorsky, it turns out that, and the evidence is colossal, that the Allies chose to kill the head of state of one of the Allies, General Sikorsky, in 1943 in Gibraltar, in the most disgusting cold-blooded way, along with his daughter and his entire cabinet, by the way. I mean, the whole lot on one plane. And they never recovered virtually any of the bodies and so on and so forth. It's very suspicious. The plane took off and crashed into the water off Gibraltar within about 20 seconds of taking off. Only survivors, the pilot, who was wearing a life vest, which he never did, and the scuba divers that investigate afterwards all disappeared and heads chopped off and unrecognizable. And it's just incredible. The cover-up, colossal. And it turns out that, you know, we're fighting for freedom and democracy while betraying all of our allies to communist terrorism. And what does it take to assassinate your own allies with his daughter and things like this? Just the cold-bloodedness of it. So that I must say that the more I've learned about the Second World War and Special Operations Executive, SOE, and the American OSS, and Wild Bill Donovan, and Churchill, and FDR, the more it turns out that I understand why an early historian that I'd studied, A.J.P. Taylor, he's one of the top historians in the Second World War from the British side, Cambridge historian, he said, and this was the first time that I really found my Second World War presuppositions challenged. He said, the Luftwaffe was not prepared for World War. They had no four-engine bombers, and they never had any seriously in plan. They never planned for any aircraft carrier, aircraft that could land or take off an aircraft carrier. While the Kriegsmarine considered an aircraft carrier and did lay the keel, never developed it. So Germany never had an aircraft carrier. And Germany's Air Force was never a strategic air force. They only had two-engine bombers with a one-ton carrying capacity maximum, whereas a British Lancaster bomber could take 14 tons each. And the British and the Americans had tens of thousands of four-engine bombers. And Germany only had a very small amount of two-engine bombers and no four-engine bombers. And when you look at the payloads and you look at the fact that America had 11 aircraft carriers, Britain had 13 aircraft carriers, France had 3 aircraft carriers, Germany had no aircraft carriers. How's Germany going to do world domination without aircraft carriers, without a four-engine bomber, and without a landing craft? They never bothered to make a landing craft. They didn't have the means of getting a tank across the channel to Britain for a hostile landing on the beaches. I mean, there's not that you exactly had beaches because you had the Cliffs of Dover and so on. But how was Germany going to do this without four-engine bombers, aircraft carrier? And if Germany wanted to, what they would have done is taken the French Navy. The French had a phenomenal Navy, and when they defeated France, they didn't bother to take the Navy. Now, if they wanted world domination, the French Navy, being the third largest Navy in the world, would have been a great step forward to helping them. But they never even requested or tried to negotiate for or take. So this is why A.J.P. Taylor and Patrick Buchanan and a whole lot of others, including your president, Herbert Hoover, came to the conclusion that Germany never wanted world domination. It was evident that her goal was in the East. Her goal was to recover the lands lost to her by the Versailles Treaty and to destroy the biggest threat to freedom in Europe, which is the Soviet Union and communism. And therefore, our Churchillian cult, which is myth and legend based on propaganda, has also motivated us to invade countries like Afghanistan, Iraq, and now Syria, on the base of there's a new Hitler and we need to be a new Churchill. And it's basically on, it shows you how the lies of history enslave and lead to extremely bad decisions in the future.
Oh, exactly. We're nearing about the end of our time. Is there anything you'd want to say before we wrap this up?
Yes. Some people may think a lot of what I've said is outrageous. So let me encourage you, get the books written by your ex-president, Herbert Hoover, Freedom Betrayed. Look at the book Churchill, Hitler, and the Unnecessary War by Patrick Buchanan. And for my documentation, you can come on our website, www.frontline.org.za, frontline.org.za. Frontline Fellowship is a mission. I've also got a history channel, which is reformationsa.org. So reformationsa for South Africa. .org. You'll see a lot of my history articles. You'll see there also links to our sermon audio and our slide share, where I've dealt with issues like, for example, the assassination of Sarajevo, the assassination of General George Patton, the sink of Lusitania, and so on. So history is very interesting to me. I've been a missionary for 35 years. I've worked amongst the persecuted church. I've specialized in reaching communists for Christ. And so it's my work in Eastern Europe and with the persecuted and a few times in prison that has really shaken my whole way that I no longer want to accept the narrative from Hollywood. And let's face it, the Bible warns us that Satan will deceive the whole world, and at the end an angel will bind Satan that he might deceive the nations no more, which means nations are being deceived today. And if we believe what the United Nations and Slime Magazine and CNN and the Bolshevik Broadcasting Corporation have to say to us today, then we're being deceived. So praise God for independent news media like your channel, and let's get the word out and let's do our own investigative reporting. Let's ask why. Let's not accept the official narrative.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much for coming on. This is Todd Lewis of the Praise of Folly podcast, signing off.